In this video, we are going to talk about Kingdom Archaea, a group of single-celled microorganisms that may share many features with early life on Earth.
For the first part of the reporting, I'm going to discuss the unifying characteristics of domain Archaea. Here's an outline of what I'm going to talk about under the unifying characteristics of the domain Archaea. Here we have first the general characteristics, next the reproduction, third the metabolism, and lastly the habitat. So for the first general characteristics of the domain Archaea is that these are a group of single-celled prokaryotic organisms, which means that these organisms lack a defined nucleus. It also lack other organelles like mitochondria. The next general characteristic is the cell wall. The cell wall of Archaea lack peptidoglycan, but they still form rigid cell boundaries that confer resistance to high internal osmotic pressure. To do this, they may have pseudopeptidoglycan, polysaccharides, glycoprotein, or protein-based cell walls that reinforce their cytoplasmic membranes. The last general characteristic that I'm going to talk about is the membrane. The chirality of the glycerol linkage in Archaea is in L-isomeric form, while in bacteria and eukarya have the D-isomeric form. Archaeal side chains are bound using ether linkages, which lacks that additional protruding oxygen atom. This gives the resulting phospholipid different chemical properties from the membrane lipids of other organisms. It also has branched hydrocarbons and forms a monolayer, sometimes chains or rings. Next, we're going to talk about the reproduction of Archaea. Archaea can reproduce through binary fission, where a parent cell divides into two genetically identical daughter cells. Archaea can also reproduce asexually through budding and fragmentation, where pieces of the cell break off and form a new cell, also producing genetically identical organisms. Next unifying characteristic is the metabolism of Archaea. First, we have phototrophs. It uses the sun's energy to produce chemical energy in the form of ATP. One example is halobacteria. Next, we have lithotrophs. It obtains energy from inorganic compounds such as sulfur or ammonia. One example of this is methanogens. And lastly, we have organotrophs. It breaks down organic materials and uses hydrogen or electrons from organic substrates. And the last unifying characteristic that I'm going to talk about is the habitat of Archaea. The Archaea originally were thought to predominate mainly in extreme environments including anaerobic waters, hot springs, and hypersaline environments such as salt lakes. Molecular methods have revealed that Archaea are common in all environments, although not as numerically dominant as in some extreme habitats.
Archaeans are known for pushing the upper temperature limit possible for life to exist. Currently, Methanopyrus candleri holds the record for growing at 122 degrees Celsius. Its optimum temperature is higher than that of the former record holder, Pyrolobus fumari, which grows at 113 degrees Celsius. The question is, how do these organisms thrive at such conditions? There are problems faced by microbes in high temperatures that may inhibit their growth. These are protein denaturation, chemical damage and spontaneous unwinding of the DNA, unstable cell membranes, and lastly, unstable ribosomal RNA. Thermophiles and hyperthermophiles adapted to these conditions through developing molecular adaptations to resolve the said problems. One of these is protein folding. The protein folding itself contributes to the thermostability of the whole structure. This involves structural modifications such as an increase in the amino acids which promote a secondary alpha helical structure. Also, the presence of highly hydrophobic cores reduces the tendency of proteins to unfold. Aside from this, an increase in ionic interactions which assist folding is present. The presence of these ionic bonds, called salt bridges, on the protein surfaces maintains the protein to be biologically active. Lastly, the presence of a class of heat-resistant proteins called chaperonins. Chaperonins are responsible in the refolding of partially denatured proteins. In Pyrodictium abyssi, a chaperonin called thermosomes keeps other proteins properly folded and functional on high temperatures. The next adaptation involves achieving DNA stability. Reverse DNA gyrase is responsible to the positive supercoiling of the Archaean DNA. This reduces the amount of DNA exposed to the risk brought by the extremely hot condition. Similar to the eukaryotic histones, highly basic DNA binding proteins bind to the Archaean DNA, compacting and compressing it to nucleosome-like structures as shown at this figure. These proteins also maintain the double-stranded form of the Archaean DNA. Lastly, Cellular solute levels are increased to prevent chemical damage, such as losing a nucleotide base through deprionation and depyrimidation. Solutes, such as putrescine and spermidine, stabilizes both nucleic acid and ribosomes on hot conditions. Another adaptation is achieving ribosomal RNA stability. As we all know, guanine and cytosine base pairs have 3 hydrogen bonds, while uracil and adenine base pairs have 2. Thus, the presence of around 15% more guanine-cytosine base pairs on hyperthermophilic and thermophilic organisms is said to be an adaptation that confers thermostability to the ribosomal RNA and to the whole ribosome itself, since the rRNAs contains the key structural and functional components of the RNA. Generally, it assists protein synthesis on high temperature conditions. The last adaptation is on membrane stability. Hyperthermophilic and thermophilic archaeans synthesized by phenyl tetraether type of lipids, which comprises their cell membranes. The tophenyl side chains on the cell structures are covalently linked, resulting to a lipid monolayer. This structure resists heat from pulling apart and destroying the membrane. Through the following adaptations, the upper limit of life is further pushed by the greatly hyperthermophilic organisms and their adaptations. It is predicted that there are still more organisms that are more hyperthermophilic than Methanopyrus that are yet to be isolated.
Next, we're going to talk about the classification of archaea. The image presents the phylogenetic tree of the archaea based on 16S rRNA gene sequence comparison. So we have two main divisions, the Euryarchaeota and the Crinarchaeota. Euryarchaeota comes from the word uraeus, which means wide or broad, and archaeos, which means ancient. And by broad, it is not that they are physically wide, but it means that they are a phylogenetically diverse phylum. It includes different lifestyles, which are the strictly anaerobic methanogens, extreme halophiles, and extreme acidophiles. They may be gram-negative or gram-positive, which is dependent on the presence of pseudomarine in their cell wall. So let's take a look at each of these groups. Extreme halophiles, also known as haloarchaea, are salt-loving microorganisms. So they inhabit environments that are high in salt. This habitat is called hypersaline. Most species of extreme halophiles require 2 to 4 molar concentration of sodium chloride for optimal growth. But organisms that require 1.5 molar of sodium chloride is already considered as an extreme halophile. Most species are obligate aerobes, and this means that they require oxygen for them to grow. Most of them use amino acids or organic acids as energy sources. They stain gram-negatively and reproduce by binary fission. Cells can be rod-shaped, coca-shaped, or cup-shaped, sometimes even squares. Next, we have methanogens, which from the name itself are microorganisms that produce methane as a byproduct of their metabolism. So methane production is called methanogenesis, and this is a process which no other life form on Earth, at least, is able to do. And this methane production has an important role in the decomposition of organic matter. It is responsible for the last step in the carbon cycle, which is the breakdown of complex carbon compounds into simple carbon molecules that is released back into the atmosphere. They grow best in moderate temperatures and are non-halophilic, but some species can grow at extreme environments, and almost all organic compounds can be converted into methane by the methanogens. The table found on the slide shows the substrates that can be converted to methane by various methanogenic archaea. They also exhibit cell wall diversity. Some cells have pseudomarine in their cell walls. Others have walls composed of methanochondroitin, and we also have protein or glycoprotein walls, as well as S-layer cell walls. Next, we have the extreme acidophiles. We first start with thermoplasma that grows optimally at 55 degrees Celsius and a pH of 2. They are facultative aerobes, which means that they can grow either aerobically or anaerobically by sulfur respiration. Next, we have ferroplasma. They are not thermophiles, as they grow optimally at 35 degrees Celsius. And from its name, they oxidize ferrous iron into ferric iron in order to get energy. And they use CO2 as their carbon source. Lastly, we have Precrophilus, which is the most acidophilic organism because they grow optimally at a pH of 0.7 and can still grow at a pH even lower than zero. And to survive this condition, they have a much lower DNA GC base ratio compared to ferroplasma and thermoplasma. They stain gram negatively and reproduce by binary fission. Cells can be rod-shaped, coca-shaped, or cup-shaped, sometimes even squares.
Next is the Kernarchaeota. Kernarchaeotes are phylogenetically distinct from Euryarchaeotes. They inhabit both ends of nature's temperature extremes. The table shown is a summary of the habitats of Kernarchaeota. Most hyperthermophilic archaea have been isolated from geothermally heated soils or waters containing sulfur and hydrogen sulfide. Also, most of these species metabolize sulfur in one way or another. Hyperthermophilic Kernarchaeotes have been obtained from terrestrial environments such as sulfur-rich springs, boiling mud, and soils where temperature reaches up to 100 degrees Celsius. They are mildly to extremely acidic owing to the production of sulfuric acid. Solfatares, which are the hot sulfur-rich environments, are found throughout the world, including Italy, Iceland, and Yellowstone National Park. Next is the home to the most thermophilic of all known archaea, which are the submarine volcanic habitats. These include both shallow water thermal springs and deep sea hydrothermal vents, which is the hottest habitat known to yield prokaryotes. Non-thermophilic Kernarchaeotes have been detected in oxic marine waters worldwide, thriving even in waters and sea ice near Antarctica. These organisms are planktonic and present in significant numbers in waters that are both nutrient poor and very cold. The morphology of Kernarchaeota are also very interesting and unique. Many microbes contain flagella, which allow that microbe to be motile. The image shows pyridium, which are disc-shaped cells connected by a network of fibers, which may help to attach to sulfur granules. These microbes can also be in many different cell shapes. Lastly, many Kernarchaeota have interesting membranes. The image shows sulfolobus. They exhibit a unique membrane composition of ether linked lipids and irregular lobe cells. These microbes flourish at pH around 2 and are found in sulfur-rich environments such as the Yellowstone hot springs. Most Kernarchaeota are obligate anaerobic. They get their energy from sulfur and carbon dioxide, which makes the majority of these microbes chemoorganotropic and chemolithotropic. Also, marine Kernarchaeota performs nitrification and plays an important role in the ocean's nitrogen cycle.
We will now be moving to the representative organisms of archaea. Halobacterium salinarum is rod-shaped, motile, and lives in a highly saline environments of 4 molar salt and higher, and is one of the few species that can live in saturated salt solutions. It can grow under aerobic and anaerobic conditions, and it enables them to grow with less interspecies competition and take advantage of the large quantity of organic matter that accrues as saline water evaporates and the non-organic matter made by photosynthesizing halophiles. It can live with light as only energy source due to the activity of bacterial rhodopsin, a light-driven proton pump. Their mass culture can also be recognized by their typical color red, which originates from bacterial rubrins, and seen on the right is the salty pond in the Arabian Desert, which is colored red due to the presence of H. salinarum. Halobacterium norescens is gram-negative, rod-shaped, and is isolated from salt deposit in Austria, believed to have been formed during the Permian period. They are free-living, and they appear as red or pink colonies due to the presence of carotenoids and bacterial rubrins. They are known to be a mesophile, and their optimum growth temperature is at approximately 37 degrees Celsius with an incubation period of 18 days. They thrive in an acidic condition at pH 5.2 to 7 and an ACL concentration between 15 to 17%. It has also been found that Halobacterium can survive in high metal concentrations because they are extremely halophilic and they are resistant to many antibiotics including vancomycin and tetracycline, but can be killed by anisomycin. Methanocoldococcus janassii is the first extremophile to be sequenced, and they lived near hydrothermal vents 2,600 meters below sea level, where temperatures approach the boiling point of water and the pressure is sufficient to crush an ordinary submarine. They survive in carbon dioxide, hydrogen, and mineral salts, and it cannot tolerate oxygen and takes care of its energy needs by producing methane. Methanocercina burkeri can produce methane anaerobically through different metabolic pathways. They have a variable morphology that when grown in freshwater medium, they grow into large multicellular aggregates, and when grown in marine environment, they grow a single irregular cocci only surrounded by the S layer. They are generally
gram variable, but they can produce gram positive stain. They have a thick cell wall compounded by a short lipid cell membrane that is similar in structure to most other methanogens, but they have no peptidoglycan layer. They have potential movement through gas vesicles that is only produced in the presence of hydrogen and carbon dioxide, likely acting as a response to hydrogen gradient. Methana brevifactor ruminantium is rod-shaped with variable motility and is able to use hydrogen and carbon dioxide and form it as substrates for methane production. Methana brevifactor urburifilis is isolated from rice paddy soil, digested sewage sludge, and recently in the human gut. They are anaerobe and mesophilic, and they have an unusually high oxygen tolerance, which was unexpected as methanogens, and especially most mesophilic members of the cytochrome lacking methanogen orders, were predicted to be particularly oxygen sensitive due to the lack of cytochrome oxidase and catalase and two heme proteins. Methana pyris candleri is rod-shaped, gram-positive methanogen that grows at 80 to 110 degrees Celsius in the H2CO2 atmosphere. Sulfolobus acidocaldarius is the first Sulfolobus species to be described. They were isolated from thermal soils and hot springs with low pH, and the spring where this species was found had a pH less than 3 and temperatures ranging from 65 to 90 degrees Celsius. They are spherical, although irregular, they usually possess slope. They have a mechanism of replication homologous to the eukaryotes, and they are facultative autotroph that when grown autotrophically, they oxidize sulfur to sulfate while fixating carbon from carbon dioxide. Sulfolobus sulfataricus have a spherical shape and a clockwise flagellum. They grow in volcanic hot springs where they have ample sulfur and low pH. They are thermoacidophile as they can live in a range of 55 to 90 degrees Celsius and with pH range of 0.9 to 5.8. They maintain their cytoplasmic pH at 6.5, and they can grow at aerobic environment in which they exist as a free-living chemolithotroph. Nanoarchaeum equitans is one of the smallest cellular organisms known, with the smallest genome among species of archaea. They were first isolated from a submarine hydrothermal vent and an obligate symbiont of the kinarchaeote ignococcus. They cannot grow in pure culture and can only replicate when attached to the surface of their symbiont. They grow to 10 or more cells per ignococcus cell and lives an apparently parasitic lifestyle.
Now, we're going to talk about a journal article that will provide an update on a newly discovered archaean species. The article entitled Nitrosospera viennensis, Gennov, Espinov, an aerobic and mesophilic ammonia oxidizing archaeon from soil, and a member of the archaeal phylum, Taumarchaeota, talks about the discovery of the first ammonia oxidizing archaean species described from the soil. It is also a species that participate in the nitrogen cycle. This article was published in the year 2014 by Viennese researchers. When a new species of microbes is discovered, it often feeds into a known genus, forming a new outermost branch in the tree of life. Sometimes, organisms are discovered with DNA that are sufficiently different from other species that they are placed into a new genus. This is the case for Nitrosospera viennensis, which is the first known member of not just a new genus, family, or even order. It belongs to a whole new class of archaea. Nitrosospera viennensis has become the first ammonia-oxidizing archaeon ever isolated from soil in pure culture. They perform a chemical reaction called ammonia oxidation, transforming ammonia and producing nitrite, which is a vital step in the global nitrogen cycle, which ensures that nitrogen is transformed into compounds more as easily accessible to plants. The isolation and production of a pure culture of Nitrosospera viennensis was groundbreaking because ammonia-oxidizing organisms are difficult to cultivate. The discovery and isolation of this species was an important step forward towards finding out more about the metabolism of ammonia-oxidizing microbes and their potential contribution of greenhouse gases such as nitrous oxide to the atmosphere. The isolation and classification of this archaeon has made an enormous contribution to archaeal taxonomy and to our understanding of what organisms contribute to the global nitrogen cycle. To know more about the discovery of this species, the DOI link for the article is shown in the slide.